By 1847, many people felt the only way they could survive is if they left Ireland. The potato crop had failed. In 1846, the failure was almost total. And so people were afraid, some that they were being punished by God. And unless they left Ireland, they really had no hope of survival. And part of the tragedy and the irony is that really so many of them died on the voyage, when they arrived in their destinations, or within a short time of arriving there. So although they saw the voyage as a voyage of survival, in fact many of them didn't survive. But they did feel that there was no hope of that for them if they remained in Ireland.
In the St. Lawrence River, about 40 kilometers east of Quebec City, is an island called Grosse Ile, where in 1832 the government established a quarantine station to intercept ships bringing immigrants to British North America. This island is the first of three important Canadian locations in this story about immigrants who were fleeing the horrific Irish Famine of 1847. These immigrants, or refugees, have been called the Famine Irish, and this is their story as they arrived on the shores of Grosse Ile. This film will follow the progress of these refugees to Montreal and later Toronto.
So the first point of contact for Irish famine refugees would have been a large island in the St. Lawrence River about 40 kilometers to the northeast of Quebec City called Grosse Ile. It had been established in 1832 as a quarantine station during the cholera epidemic of that year, and it maintained that status. And so in 1846, George Mellis Douglas, the chief medical officer on the island, was dealing with the first of Irish refugees. But the worst year, of course, 1847, meant that Douglas would have had a much greater crisis on his hands. So when a ship would land at Grosse Ile, essentially it would anchor off the island. Douglas would either personally or one of his physicians would row out to the ships and inspect the passengers for any traces of what they called ship's fever, which essentially was typhus. Any passengers suspected of having the disease by that preliminary check would be loaded onto that rowboat and other boats that would come out to the ship, and then they would be taken to the island to the lazarettos that were built there. Although it got to a point by the summer of 1847 that there wasn't enough room in many of the lazarettos. Tents had to be erected. Sometimes there were two and three persons infected in a bunk. Sometimes there were potential cases there that were cheek by jowl to those who actually had typhus. It's a highly communicable bacterial infection, and so that meant some of the healthy people who had been landed on Grosse Ile also got sick and died. And so by the end of that horrific summer, over 5,000 people were buried as victims of typhus and of hunger on Grosse Ile.
Grosse Ile has been developed by Parks Canada to welcome visitors who want to learn about the role that this quarantine station played in 19th and early 20th century immigration to Canada. After extensive public consultations throughout the 1990s, Parks Canada developed the theme and focus of the national park we see today. It is named Grosse Ile and the Irish Memorial National Historic Site of Canada, and it can be reached by fast ferry. In 1998, Parks Canada erected a remarkable memorial designed by Quebec artist Lucien Cornet to the approximately 5,400 Irish immigrants buried in this field, seen through the glass walls of the memorial. The names of all those buried here and the ships that carried them are etched on these glass panels as a silent memorial to honor the dead. The park features exhibits about advances in disease detection and control, as well as tours of immigrant hotels built later. But in this documentary, we will concentrate on the arrival of Irish emigrants fleeing starvation and the Great Famine of 1847. And in particular, the response of early Canadian men and women, French and English, Catholic and Protestant, to Canada's first major refugee crisis.
So by 1846, 1847, people had actually been on the verge of starvation for almost 2 years. And really, emigration was a final act of desperation. They fled in desperation as far as they could get away from Ireland in many ways. And so people who travelled were already impoverished and malnourished. And then they had to face the ordeal of a journey that could take 5, 6, 7, or 8 weeks, often in very poor conditions. Unfortunately, the passenger trade was very badly regulated. There was very little government intervention. And many of the ships that were used to take passengers to North America were in fact timber ships, ships that were bringing timber or corn or other goods to Europe, to Britain, to Ireland. And literally, Irish people were ballast on the journey back. So the ships were not really designed to cope with passengers. Again, we know from recent research that not all ships had medical officers. The ships that did have good medical officers tended to have the highest rate of survival. But people who fled in 1847 in mass numbers just took any ship they could get. They didn't worry about that. And so by the time people arrived in their destinations, New York, Boston, or Grosse Ile, and then onward to Montreal, they were really in even worse condition than they had been when they left Ireland.
In 1847, a huge wave of immigrants crossed the Atlantic. There was around 100,000 people, mostly Irish, and they fled the Great Famine. We had room for around 1,000 person at the same time here on the island, and ships after ships, waves after waves kept arriving, and the infrastructures were completely inadequate to accommodate peaks of up to 12,000 people at the same time. So the idea of this building was to try to accommodate a few of them. There was room for up to 300 people at the same time, and there were 12 buildings like this one that were built. So room for 3,600 people at the same time, but it's too little and too late. So you have 12 buildings. They're not supposed to be hospitals. They're not supposed to be something specific. They are sheds to accommodate people. As you see around you, there's a lot of beds, but there's pretty much nothing else. So it's supposed to be ventilated all the time. There's no place to maybe put a fire or to heat the building in any way. There's no place to cook. There's no place to wander. It's really just to sleep.
Yeah, in the summer of and fall of 1847, Dr. Douglas had all of his expectations washed away. He hadn't anticipated that somewhere in the neighborhood of 109,000 migrants would actually leave British and Irish ports that year. 17,000 of those migrants would actually go to Partridge Island in New Brunswick. A few hundred would end up in other maritime colonies, but Grosse Ile itself faced about three times the number that Douglas had expected, in around 90,000, although children were counted differently, so we really don't have an exact fix on the numbers, but we can presume that it was 90,000 or better that would have passed through the island.
Some of the diaries of some of the priests who were helping tell heartbreaking stories of going out to these ships and with dozens of dead people and the sick and even a few remaining healthy people on board with sort of stuck on these ships with dead people. And they had heartbreaking scenes where one little child was playing with the hand of his dead mother. It was unimaginable sorrow.
Now, this meant conditions were critical. They needed more buildings, they needed more people, more orderlies, more doctors, more to help treat the sick that were being unloaded off the ships after that horrendous 6 to 8 week voyage across the Atlantic. And in the end, there was a high human cost. The Irish migrants themselves, some 5,000 lay buried at Grosse Ile, and that doesn't account for the numbers of orderlies and doctors and other service persons who came onto the island as part of the relief effort and ended up contracting typhus and dying and being buried on the island as well.
5,424 men, women, and children are buried in this field in a mass grave. Their names and the names of the 441 ships that carried them here are etched in glass so they will never be forgotten. Medical support staff, soldiers, clergy, volunteers, and four doctors died serving the Irish refugees who landed at Grosse Ile. Dr. George Douglas, the medical superintendent, erected this stone pillar to honor these four doctors in particular. Their names, which appear on this monument, speak of the cultural diversity of the first responders to this crisis. They are Dr. John Benson of Dublin, Dr. Alexandre Pinet of Arène, Quebec, Dr. Alfred Maillot of Verchères, Quebec, and Dr. John Jameson of Montreal. The inscription reads, "These gentlemen were assistant medical officers of this hospital, and all died of typhus fever contracted in the faithful discharge of their duty upon the sick." As the ferry approaches Grosse Ile, a prominent Celtic cross comes into view perched on the highest point of land on the island. It was erected in 1909 by the Ancient Order of Hibernians and stands 40 feet tall. It was designed by Jeremiah O'Gallagher, the grandfather of Mariana O'Gallagher, a champion in the development of Grosse Ile as a memorial to the Irish famine migrants. It has four panels, three of which describe the tragedy of the Great Famine, while the fourth names the priests who ministered to the Irish immigrants, with one star for those who contracted typhus and two for those who died. Here is Mariana leading a guided tour in 2008, 2 years before her death, as she reflected on the loss of human potential at Grosse Ile.
As Gerard played, I'm sure that many of us were thinking of how many musicians died, how many young people who were just learning and just beginning to love their music, how many writers, how many scamps, how many old gossips who were there with their whole village, mothers and fathers, men and women and children, dying and in search of something better for themselves and for those around them.
While this documentary was being filmed, Irish writer and ultra-runner Michael Collins started a 900-kilometer marathon run retracing the route taken by the famine Irish from Grosse Ile to Toronto. His diaspora run made headlines in Ireland and Canada, and we will meet up with him later in this film as he arrives at Ireland Park in Toronto.
Waves after waves of immigrants came through here, and there's around 700 orphans that were taken by the different families. For the all those who have Irish blood in Quebec and the Irish folks and a lot of people all around North America, Grosse Ile is considered as a sacred site. And it's really telling. There's really a lot of remnants of what happened here. If you look, for example, the cemetery, the Celtic Cross, or the memorial on Grosse Ile, where all the names of all the immigrants are listed. So when we think about the Irish memorial, we're almost talking about the whole island and a big part of our history, where there was a lot of suffering, but also a lot of care. That was given by the workers here and in a more general way, maybe by the entire population that was welcoming those who suffered.
Mark McGowan summarizes the tragedy of Grosse Ile while providing a hint at what is yet to come in this story of emigrants and first responders.
So in 1847, the crisis was so acute at Grosse Ile that that Dr. Douglas had to call in more personnel, that is doctors, orderlies, and even clergy to assist with the dead and the palliative. And one of the horrors of this for first responders is that those that they allowed pass through quarantine, that is those who they thought weren't infected, may have been incubating typhus because it has about a 10-day incubation period. So a person who's infected doesn't look like they're infected, and those signs will start materializing, those symptoms, in places like Quebec City when they land there and Montreal. And so the first responders who come to the wharves and to the sheds and to the hospitals and those centers are equally susceptible, even though they're farther down the chain of reception than those who had been at Grosse Ile.
As the wave of Irish refugees, 60,000 strong, cleared by Dr. Douglas and the volunteer medical staff at Grosse Ile, moved up the St. Lawrence River towards Montreal, a city of 54,000 citizens, it became increasingly obvious the typhus came with them.
The problem with the rickettsia bacteria and with typhus itself is that it's a very hardy bacteria. So it can live on blankets, it can live on beds, it can live on linens, it can even live in the dirt upon which those beds sit. And so every responder who takes in a victim is at great risk of contracting the disease themselves.
This building, close to the harbor in Old Montreal, was the original home of Margaret de Youville and her Sisters of Charity, who came to be known as the Grey Nuns. Today, it is the general house for the Congregation of Grey Nuns, with some rooms furnished as they were in 1847. The Grey Nuns were the first order to respond to the request to care for the famine Irish, but not the last.
The summer of 1847 in Montreal was a summer like no other one. Since they had seen for many years before. There had been rumors that there were ships coming in from Grosse Ile with people who were very, very sick. And it seems that at the beginning of June of 1847, these ships arrived here in Montreal. And it's true, they were laden with people who were extremely ill from the typhus. And that became known as the typhus epidemic.
They didn't appear ill yet, but by the time they got down here to Montreal, they were ill. And they started coming off the boats, and they were on the shores there in what we sometimes call Point St. Charles. And they needed care. And the Sulpician priests asked the Grey Nuns to help.
The ships came in Montreal Harbor in what is now called Old Montreal, which would be right about here. And as you can see, it's just a very short walk into Griffintown and into the area where the sheds were. And in fact, at one point near the end of the summer, there was an attempt to have the ships bypass the wharves, and they came directly to this area where the hospital sheds were.
Seven Grey Nuns perished in the fever sheds of Montreal in June and early July of 1847. They were replaced by a second order of nuns called the Sisters of Providence. They too suffered fatalities, and at the end of July, they were replaced by a third order of nuns called the Religious Hospitallers of St. Joseph. And what is remarkable about this is that the Religious Hospitallers of St. Joseph were a cloistered order of nuns, an order of nuns who never left their convent. And yet, they petitioned the bishop, Bishop Bourget, to break their cloister, to leave their convent, and to go out into the city to replace their fallen sisters and to care for the famine Irish.
Alors, elles avaient déjà supplié Monseigneur d'aller les soigner. Et Monseigneur leur a dit à un certain moment que les sœurs grises étaient très épuisées. Peut-être qu'elle pourrait aller les soigner. Parce que, après consultation, Monseigneur dit, le précepte de la charité l'emportait sur la loi de la clôture. Donc, c'est ça qui a permis aux sœurs d'aller les soigner et de permettre un répit aux communautés religieuses qui soignaient aussi les malades.
In the ceiling of the entrance to Bon Secours Church in Old Montreal is a painting called Le Typhus by Quebec artist Théophile Hamel. Bishop Ignace Bourget commissioned this visual account of the roles of the three congregations as they ministered to the Irish immigrants arriving in the port of Montreal. Dr. Jason King and Dr. Christine Keneally mounted an exhibition called Saving the Famine Irish, based in large part on this eyewitness account of the roles of the Grey Nuns and the other congregations.
So the painting is fascinating on many levels. It's beautiful, it's evocative, it's painful in some ways to look at. And its origins lay in the fact that the Bishop of Montreal actually gave support to the sisters, and he contracted what was known as famine fever or Irish fever. And he was fortunate in that he survived. And so he commissioned a local artist in Montreal, a classically trained artist, to create this wonderful image to depict the story of what had happened. And it's on the ceiling of a church in Montreal to this day. So in some ways, it's hard for the casual visitor to see. And it shows in fine detail the three religious orders.
What we see in that painting is the three orders of nuns working in succession to care for the famine Irish. In the foreground of the painting, we see the Grey Nuns. In the middle ground of the painting, we see the Sisters of Providence. And behind the Sisters of Providence, we see the religious hospitallers of St. Joseph. In the very back of the painting, with Bishop Bourget himself tending to one of the famine Irish.
But what makes this unique and so poignant is that you see scenes of death. And this is very unusual. In terms of 19th century art or photography, at this stage, people didn't want to depict suffering. Most artists had been taught in terms of high art. And so to actually see scenes like this is really unique. It probably is the first painting of the Great Hunger in the world, in terms of one that depicts the actual outcome of starvation.
It has been there since 1847, a very important painting, an eyewitness painting that depicts the arrival of the famine Irish, but also a painting that is almost completely unknown to famine scholars, to the public at large. So this exhibit, Saving the Famine Irish, is based around the painting, and what it does is it finds episodes, incidents, stories in the annals of the Grey Nuns and their correspondences with the visual images that we find in the painting.
While crossing the courtyard, he sees...
Reading from the annals of the Grey Nuns, Sister Faye tells a story that is depicted very poignantly in the right corner of the Hamel painting, of an Irish man whose wife was sent on ahead to Montreal while he was recovering from typhus at Grosse Ile. Arriving from Grosse Ile, he discovers his wife among the dead in a fever shed in Point St. Charles.
He takes her in his arms, seeming to doubt that she is in fact dead. He wants to bring her back to life, talks to her, calls her by her name, kisses her tenderly. But for all these demonstrations, the only answer he receives is death's silence.
The Grey Nuns, as well as the Sisters of Saint, the Hospitallers of St. Joseph, were first responders. They were there. The people had come. And so recognizing first responders always place themselves in danger, whether it's fire, whether it's flood, whatever it is. And in this case, it was an epidemic. And it had many of the same qualities, I believe, that the first responders of the Ebola virus had. The same qualities were there, caring for the persons with AIDS when so little was known about AIDS. Again, willingness to put your life in danger in order to accompany people who may be dying, who may be very ill, and offering relief and comfort. As first responders, they were thinking in terms of, okay, what happens next? And this is where our story of taking the orphans comes in.
Mother Emily Gamelin, the superior and foundress of the Sisters of Providence, arranged with her cousin, Mrs. Nolan, to rent her home on St. Catherine Street as an orphanage for the children of the Irish immigrants. and over 100 were moved by a parade of carriages on one day, with the collaboration of Bishop Bourget of Montreal and the Congregation of Notre Dame, who assisted with transportation, food, and places to rest.
I feel very proud of these women, of whom I'm a descendant, and that they would not hesitate in the face of such hardship. And so I just sense a lot of gratitude for their gift of self. And it's wonderful. It's wonderful what they did.
After the death of the three sisters who died, there were still many of the sisters who had contracted the typhus. And Bishop Bourget brought all of the sisters together, and with the support of Mother Gamelin, suggested that a vow be made. And the vow was presented on the feast of St. Vincent de Paul on July 19th, and with the whole community together, imploring our Mother of Sorrows to be able to protect the sisters and help them to get well and protect the others who would be caring for the people with typhus. And the vow was to light 7 candles every Friday for the rest of the life of the community of the Sisters of Providence. Here at our mother house in Montreal, the candles are lit every Friday, and they're in the chapel right next to the main altar. So very visible for everyone to see and to remember our story.
But as lovingly as the story of the first responders is recorded in the annals of the religious congregations, the only public memorial in Montreal is this black rock on an island between the on-ramps at the Victoria Bridge in Point St. Charles. The dedication reads, "To preserve from desecration the remains of 6,000 immigrants who died of ship fever, 1847 to 48. This stone is erected by the workmen of Messrs. Pito, Brassi, and Betts, employed in the construction of the Victoria Bridge, 1859.
And 6,000 plus people died right where we're standing. We're actually standing on the graves of our Irish ancestors. When they started to build the Victoria Bridge, the workers, many who were Irish, started unearthing bones. And when they started digging into the story, because it was 1859, that not that long after 1847, so the story was still relatively in the modern conscious of the time, they decided to take this boulder and lay it as a headstone to the 6,000 plus Irish.
But it's a lot more than an Irish story. It's a Montreal story, it's a Quebec story, and it's really a Canadian story. Because as these Irish were dying in Quebec, both at Grosse Ile and certainly here in Montreal, people went to help them. For example, the mayor of Montreal in 1847 was a gentleman by the name of John Mills. John Mills was not Catholic. John Mills was not Irish. But he went into the sheds after he finished doing whatever it is a mayor does all day. Every night he went into the sheds to nurse the dying Irish. Eventually, he got typhus himself, and he died in November of 1847.
But by that time, the tide had public opinion had turned, and his funeral was one of the most well-attended events in the history of Montreal.
Victor Boyle explains that the Montreal Irish Monument Foundation would like to create a cultural green space to honor the 6,000 buried here and to celebrate those who came to their aid.
So what we're proposing to do is to take the parking lot that we're standing on right now, as well as the cement factory that we see to my left here, and convert it to a green space with a GAA field, and this would be a park, and we'll move the stone from its current location to pretty much just in front of where I'm standing, and replace that island just with a Celtic cross so people realize it really is a cemetery. For years, people have thought this stone was some dedication to the people who built the Victoria Bridge, when in fact, It's the people who built the Victoria Bridge who placed that there as a dedication to the 6,000 Irish that were buried and in some cases disturbed during the construction of that bridge.
The journey of the famine Irish continued up the St. Lawrence River to Lake Ontario, to towns like Cornwall and Kingston. But Toronto was the destination for over 38,000 emigrants who survived Grosse Ile and Montreal.
About 38,000 people land in that summer and early autumn of 1847 in a city of little more than 20,000 people. The response of Torontonians is really quite remarkable given its historic reputation as being the Belfast of North America. So the first responders in Toronto are Roman Catholic, they're Anglican, they're Protestant. They put themselves on the line to do the same type of triaging that had been done in the earlier ports of call. In the end, about 1,124 famine migrants die in the sheds that are located at the corner of King Street and John. And unfortunately, the same thing happens in Toronto as has happened earlier, and that is that the first responders begin to die as well.
Some 20% of the famine Irish who arrived in Toronto were Protestant, and here at St. James Cemetery in downtown Toronto, 281 are buried. Their names are recorded in the burial registry. Ireland Park Foundation dedicated this memorial to them.
Unveiled by Her Excellency Mary McLeese, who is President of Ireland, and it was unveiled on June 21st, 2007, as a memorial and commemorating the 281 men, women, and children who are buried in this plot, who died on their way here or died here in Toronto during the typhus epidemic. There's on record Anglican clergy who were serving those who were coming.
The Roman Catholic dead were buried at St. Paul's Church Cemetery, but as Mark McGowan explains, the location of the bodies is shrouded in mystery.
The dead in Toronto provide both a historical and an archaeological conundrum. What we do know is that there were three spots where the dead from the fever sheds at King and John could have been buried. Very few of them were buried at Potter's Field. Protestants were generally taken to St. James Cemetery, and the Catholics were taken to St. Paul's Cemetery, which was a large plot of land behind the small Catholic church, St. Paul's, which is on Power Street today. What we do know is that over time, that cemetery became pretty much derelict, which made it very difficult for local Torontonians to figure out just where that cemetery began and where it ended. Now, what we do know is that as they began digging in that land around St. Paul's, they began finding human remains. For example, in 1932, when the Sisters of St. Joseph at the House of Providence were digging an extension to their hospital, it's clear that they must have intruded upon the original St. Paul's Cemetery. And it's only rather interestingly that year, in 1932, which marks no significant centennial or sesquicentennial of the Irish Famine at all, an Irish Famine memorial appears with pietà that had been created to commemorate Dean Hand, who had been the pastor at St. Paul's for a long time. But that monument now also becomes a monument to the famine dead. And we think that there must have been some recognition by the sisters at that point that what they had done was actually intruded upon the cemetery inadvertently while digging an extension. So what we have is a cemetery that essentially served the Catholic dead of 1847 being forgotten and then being remembered only when spades and shovels went in the ground to land that people locally had forgotten had been a cemetery.
Although the burial place is not precisely identified, there is a public memorial to the famine Irish who finally arrived in Toronto in 1847. and its name is Ireland Park. Built by the Ireland Park Foundation and opened in 2007 by Irish President Mary McAleese, it sits on Erin Quay at the foot of Bathurst Street on the waterfront, not far from the original Breese's Pier, where Irish emigrants landed in 1847.
In many respects, the park is a cemetery without bodies. It's made up of five bronze sculptures, a glass beacon or tower, and at the western boundary, a series of 14 columns of limestone quarried in Ireland and brought here for the construction of the park. In the gaps between the columns are engraved the names of some 675 men, women and children whose names we were able to recover from research in the city's archives and in the Hawke papers which came to light just prior to the commencement of construction of the park.
We had decided that we would build the park with Irish limestone, and we selected this quarry and made a visit there so I could see firsthand the quality and texture of the stone and how what they could do, how big the pieces could be. And that enabled us to create a composition of stone that was quite monumental and somewhat representative of a natural Irish rock landscape. But we were able to build it and cut it so that we could incorporate the names of the famine migrants who had arrived in Toronto in the cuts through the wall. So the experience is one of walking around that stonework and discovering the names in the wall, almost like the way you discover the fossils also in the stonework. The slots that the names are in are of different widths because, as we hope Professor McGowan will find other names in due course, we left wider slots where currently there are no names, where those names could be added. And it leaves enough space for a person to get in there and cut the names into the sawn face of the stone.
The five bronze sculptures behind me are the work of Irish sculptor Rowan Gillespie, who created the seven bronze sculptures on the waterfront in Dublin. The five on the waterfront of Toronto react and respond to the loss of life that took place on the journey across the Atlantic and upon arrival in Canada. Rowan was inspired by the story of the response to the migrants and the crisis in this city in 1847 to create the group that stands behind me. The man with upraised arms was a form and shape that he responded to in coming down here very early one morning to watch the sunrise over the eastern horizon. The pregnant woman speaks to hope for the next generation. The orphan boy reflects that confusion of migrants, of uncertainty about whether to go forward or to go back. The woman on the ground depicted in the last moments of life speaks to that tragedy of all forms of disease and distress for migrants all over the world to this very day. The fifth figure is inspired by Joseph O'Connor's book, The Star of the Sea, and depicts the character Pius Mulvey. It's a quiet contemplative place with a great view to the east, to the sunrise, to the future of a city that these migrants will help build. And it is a testament to the triumph over adversity of the very determined people who overcame tremendous hardship to reach the shores of Canada, where they found a welcome.
Arriving after a 900-kilometer marathon he named the Diaspora Run, which began in Grosse Ile and ends here at Ireland Park in the Toronto Harbour, is Irish author and ultra-runner Michael Collins. Michael retraced the journey from Grosse Ile to Toronto by running a marathon a day. He explains his motivation.
Again, in Irish culture, Irish society, somehow we've had a hard time managing what happened during those terrible years. So when I went to school, it was kind of glossed over. So it was really the Quebecois, the Canadian people in general, who brought it to my attention. And I called the Irish Times and told them that I really felt that we hadn't done enough for our own country. But then also, as I read about what the Canadians did for the Irish, You often hear about what the Americans do for the Irish, but the Canadians maybe are kind of quieter and they just do stuff without compliment. So I felt that it was also a run to thank the Canadians for what they did over the years.
So one of the great revelations I had in Ontario was through social media, Irish Canadian organizations came out to tell the story of the Irish, but also to tell the story of the Canadians. I mean, they were proud of Cornwall, Rockville, you know, what they actually did, Kingston as well. So they built Celtic crosses, put things up to enshrine the Irish passage, but I think also to enshrine their sense of dignity and service to other people.
I think one of the most remarkable stories of this whole episode in Canadian history in 1847 is the way that Canadians themselves stood up and really responded in an effective and self-sacrificing way to those who were coming in. These Irish who obviously may have created certain health dangers for them. But we have numerous people within this city of Toronto, clergy, religious, and others, Catholic, Protestant, stepping up and assisting their brothers and sisters when they were in need. The Bishop of Toronto at the time, Michael Power, was particularly remarkable because his priests who had been tending to the fever sheds, they fell stricken with this disease. So Bishop Power was alone, essentially, without his priests, going daily to the sheds. In fact, it's remarkable that when the first Loretto sisters arrived, whom he had recruited that year from Ireland, they found him in a worried and frustrated state. They found him paranoid almost that these new sisters who had come to serve in Toronto would become infected as well. It was in short order after their arrival in September that Michael Power himself contracted typhus and died on October 1st, just shy of his 43rd birthday. And he's not the only story. The story of Edward McElderry with a large family who triaged people at the wharf. He dies at the end of the sailing season. Susan Bailey, the head nurse, she dies as a result of contracting typhus. Dr. Grissette, the chief medical officer at the hospital for only a few weeks, dies of typhus. This really becomes a remarkable story of those who were on shore, greeting and serving, who didn't live to see the end of the year.
The Ireland Park Foundation is opening a second park here at the corner of Adelaide Street West and Widmer Streets in downtown Toronto. Dr. George Robert Grissette Park will be opened in June 2017. This street corner on a busy east-west artery was part of the hospital reserve, where patients with communicable diseases like cholera in the 1830s and typhus in 1847 were kept separate from the population of this growing colonial city. It was here that at least 12 pitched roof fever sheds without walls were constructed on the grounds of the hospital reserve. In order to offer protection from mosquitoes, the staff hung cheesecloth for makeshift walls, allowing for fresh air. The park will be situated right here at Adelaide West, formerly Newgate, and Widmer Streets, and will honor Dr. George Robert Grissette, Chief Attending Surgeon, Dr. Joseph Hamilton, Head Nurse Susan Bailey, Nurse Sarah Duggan, Medical Orderlies John McNabb and Richard Jones, and Edward McElderry, Emigrant Officer. These first responders gave their lives to minister to the Irish migrants and will be celebrated in glass, granite, cheesecloth which protected the migrants from insects, and limestone that speak a timeless tale of strife, passage, hope, and sacrifice.
And this park will really celebrate and commemorate the role of medical people and people in community and religious organizations who step forward to face danger, to risk their lives, to help those in desperate need, in terrible distress. And it's part of that personality of our city that we've always welcomed migrants and that we have been courageous in dealing with these crises. And I think in the current time frame, it's important that we restore this story to memory and celebrate their bravery and their courage.
it really gives us, I think, an inspiration to be those who are the merciful, those who are the compassionate, those who are willing to recognize in those in need that call to serve one another, to serve your fellow human beings, whether it be in 1847 or in 2016.
When my ancestors were in need, when the Irish were in need, they were welcomed by the Canadians, a great risk to themselves. And I think the lesson is there today. When other people seek help from us, we should do no less.